everyone. I'm Marjorie Morgan. I'm Associate Executive Director for Outpatient Services. And my question of the talk this evening is going to be about the impact of trauma, particularly on teens, and the ways that we can support kids when they've been through some kind of a trauma. And I'm going to, and even though the series focused on certain kinds of trauma, I just want to bring some awareness that there are all kinds of different ways that people can be impacted by something that just throws them off their usual routine. And so I'm going to be defining trauma broadly, even beyond the kinds of things that were depicted in the series. A lot of the things that Nicole was talking about in terms of symptoms of mental health disorders can also stem simply from experiencing a trauma. So it doesn't necessarily assume these kinds of things. It doesn't necessarily mean that the person does have a mental illness, but they can be things that could happen to any one of us if we experience some sort of a traumatic event. And I think that part of what gets a lot of folks into trouble is that experiencing those kinds of things, like the kinds of things that Hannah experienced in the series, or the other sexual assaults that were depicted, it's such a painful thing that looking for a way to escape is just job one. It feels so, people can feel so desperate. And that's sometimes where the drugs and alcohol come in, but it's also sometimes where it's just, let me try to screen it out and not think about it at all, because it's just too painful. I do want to make one reference to suicide theory by Dr. Joyner, who was our speaker here a couple of years ago. Because when I was watching the last couple of episodes in the series, I just was struck by Hannah exhibiting all three of these factors that Dr. Joyner talks about. So he talks about the sense of thwarted belongingness, not feeling like I belong, not feeling, she didn't feel connected, she was withdrawing from people, she tried to connect and just didn't feel like that was working for her. So she didn't have a sense of belongingness. I think also there was an impact that she had moved recently to this new town. The perceived burdensomeness, feeling like she's a burden, she talked about her parents and the stress and strain that they were under with the business and financial worries, and she did say at one point, my parents would be better off without me, I'm too much of a burden on them. And then the acquired capacity refers to people who've had an experience where they've already experienced some kind of pain or they've come close to facing death or severe injury. When you've had that kind of experience, it kind of desensitizes you to it, which puts you more at risk. And I really feel as though Hannah was in that middle part there where she was experienced all three of those factors. Well, that's really discouraging. That's really discouraging. But what I want to say is that the top circle and the one on the right are things that we can do something about. If somebody's already experienced some sort of trauma, they've been through something really painful, they've got that acquired capacity, they've been a little desensitized to it, something that's happened has already happened. We can't go back and make it unhappen. But in terms of helping someone feel like they're still connected and they belong, that's something we can do something about. In terms of reassuring someone that they're not a burden and that we would do anything to help them, that's something we can do about. We can do something about that. So I just wanted to throw this slide in there, even though I'm anticipating Chris's part on suicide prevention. So in the aftermath of a trauma, what kinds of things do people need and what can we do? Obviously, the first and foremost important thing is to believe them and to avoid minimizing, which was what something that was happening in the reporter's office. There were various people along the way who were really kind of, it'll be okay. You know, you're going to have to move on. That's not where we need to be. And I think sometimes when we are talking to someone that we care very deeply about and they're hurting tremendously, what we want to do is make them feel better. And so it's so tempting to try to rush through and get to the part where it'll be okay. You know, one day you'll look back on this and it won't matter as much. If we get to that too fast, it's another way of kind of minimizing and saying, yeah, this thing that you're thinking is the most horrible thing that ever happened to anybody, I'm going to say it's not that big a deal. So you don't want to minimize, but at the same time, especially if you're a parent, speaking for myself, it really doesn't help if we overreact. Well, I'm going to get away in that school, I'm going to give a piece of my own. I'm going to gather up a posse, I'm going to go get that kid. it's just real easy to overreact because, again, you want to protect, you want to take care of, but that's going to be kind of overwhelming to an adolescent who's been through something awful, and they're going to say, no, back off, I don't need to talk to you anymore because you're not listening to me. We do want to encourage kids to talk to us about this kind of thing and show support, but sometimes they're just not going to, they can't get the words out, they're not sure that they want to tell you yet. The most important thing is to not give up. And sometimes all you can do is be that supportive person who's sitting with, who's just available. If the kid says, I'm not going to talk about this right now, I just can't, and we walk away and distance ourselves, then when they are ready, it's that much harder for them to come forward. So just being around, showing that you can be strong and you're going to be available to them whenever they're ready is the best thing that we can do. Sometimes it helps to ask, how can I help you? Sometimes they're going to say, if I knew that, I wouldn't be coming to you. But you certainly need to be validating that the way that this person is telling you they're feeling after this difficult experience they've had is probably the way most people would feel if they'd had that experience. So it doesn't mean they're crazy or bad or wrong. It's a normal reaction to the kind of thing that they've been through. You certainly want to be careful and be aware about what kinds of things they're watching online or doing online. The social media is such a huge factor on how our kids cope and how they feel about things. And so you want to certainly have some awareness. I certainly think that this particular series, while it's generated a lot of terrific conversations, it's not the best thing to be watching if you're a really vulnerable kid that's just been through something pretty rough. That's the thing that I think has been concerning all of us so much, is that if young people are watching this and they're really vulnerable and they're not talking about what they're seeing, trying to process what is going on, that's when we would have some real concern. Guilt and shame really come to the fore, especially with the kind of sexual assault kinds of things that were depicted in this series. Making a distinction between guilt, where someone did something that they're not pleased with, versus shame, feeling I'm no good as a person. So making that distinction. But lots of times, especially when the trauma was a sexual assault, there's a feeling of shame around it. And we want to reassure the victim that what happened was not their fault. Really important that we help them distinguish, even if they did something that was maybe a mistake, to help them distinguish between what they need to take responsibility for and what was not their responsibility. The whole notion in the series about this, about revenge, like I'm going to tell all the people who hurt me, how they hurt me, and then they'll feel really bad. That's a very tempting thing, and it's very worrisome. So I think that if you have someone that you're close to who's been through something, especially when it's the kind of bullying or shaming and rejecting that was going on in the school, to be talking about the desire for revenge and the feelings of anger and shame, to give that sort of an outlet without needing to carry it out in the way that Hannah did in the series. If there was some aspect of what happened that the teen said, you know, I made a mistake or I didn't do the right thing, we certainly want to be talking about that and talking about how can we make amends, what can we do better differently the next time. But at the same time, I have no idea what that message means, but it keeps getting back. We want to really be careful, even if the kids say, you know, I should never have gone to that party. That was my first mistake. I should never, well, maybe, yeah, maybe that wasn't a great decision. But we want to make a distinction between, okay, let's learn from this thing that happened that was horrible, and how can you increase your chances of being safe the next time versus blaming the victim. It's so important that we not heap more suffering on top of the distress that the person's already feeling by saying, you know, you shouldn't have been wearing that, or I told you not to go over there. We really want to make a difference between those two things and make sure that we're not doing anything that communicates that we're saying it was the fault of the victim. I I think that there's an awful lot of talk in schools now about bullying, anti-bullying programs, and I don't know that I have something that's brand new here, but I think that thinking about both strengthening all of us, especially kids, but all of us, to stand up and call it out when we see it, is the role of the bystander is hugely important. If there's any cyberbullying or any threats or violence, those are the kinds of things that certainly need to be reported to the police, because those things are very scary and serious, and we don't want them to continue to ramp up. So if a person's really hurting and they're really in distress, here are some basic kinds of ways that we can help a person manage those overwhelming emotions that are flooding and making it very hard to think and focus or even to function. So one group of things that we can talk about is trying to just sort of simmer the emotions down by doing things that help us relax, that are soothing, that are peaceful, and to think of kinds of things that might come under this heading. You can think about the five senses. So what are some things that if I looked at them, it would make me feel a little calmer? Maybe that's pictures of people I care about. Maybe it's a soothing scene like this. Maybe it's something outdoors. What are some things that if I listened to them, it would make me feel a little bit calmer, a little more serene? Music is a powerful influencer of mood. And you want to make sure that if somebody's feeling down, that they're not listening to music that's going to take them further down. But soothing kinds of music, talking to someone you care about. Smell is another very strong influencer of mood, so having a nice scented lotion rub on the body or essential oils. Taste can be a little tricky, so maybe we're going to look at a nice cup of tea or maybe a hard candy or a crunchy pretzel or something, as opposed to trying to get rid of the emotions with just eating comfort food. And touch is the other. So cuddling up and under a nice cozy blanket, petting the family dog, having a hug, those kinds of things. So just generating ideas of what are some things, if I'm having a bad day, what are some things I can do that are soothing and calming to me. The second category is getting distracted, you know, finding something that holds your attention and getting involved in something, even if it's just for half an hour, it can help you get your mind off the trauma, therefore, again, the emotions are calming down and I can think a little bit more clearly now about what I need to do. Mindfulness practice and meditation are certainly hugely important. Nicole had mentioned paying attention to things like exercise, sleep, and nutrition, which also sort of strengthen us and make us less vulnerable to all these negative emotions. Sticking to routine or creating routine is very helpful. If a person's been through a trauma, one of the things that's happened is that they've lost a sense of loss of control, sense of loss of power. So things that are predictable and standard and routine can be very comforting and help, again, sort of get re-regulated. And this is not a time to engage, allow other kinds of stress to get heaped on top. It's a time to sort of pare things down and try to keep it as calm as possible. So what do people who have suffered a trauma really need in order to heal and recover? The first thing they need is being heard and respected. But the second thing they need is to redevelop a sense of safety. If you think about the kinds of things that were happening in this series, all of a sudden the world didn't seem like a safe place. Even places that used to seem safe were not safe anymore for the characters in the show. And so helping people find ways to feel safe again. So maybe that means we get a dog that's going to bark. I mean, it doesn't even have to be establishing safety around the particular trauma that happened. When someone suffered a severe trauma, like the sexual assault or a physical assault, it's going to heighten their feeling of not being safe sort of across the board. So anything we can do that will help a person feel more safe, more secure, is going to help with the healing process. And then the third piece that needs to happen here is reestablish a sense of autonomy and power. Nicole was talking about this, the feeling of helplessness. That's really sort of soul destroying. So anything we can do that helps the person feel as though I still have choices in my life, I can still make decisions about what I'm going to do or what's going to happen. Anything that allows them to feel like I'm getting back in the driver's seat of my own life and I'm not just sort of rolling along where life takes me. Those are the kinds of things that we need to experience and feel in our lives in order to recover from this level of trauma. Sometimes when, especially if you're the adult, sometimes even if you're the friend of the person who's suffering and they don't want to talk about it and they leave me alone, I'm done. What are some things that we can do? And the first thing is to not give up. Channel your inner Winston Churchill and you never, 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 never give up. Tolerate the, some lack of disclosure. If you remember the scene in the guidance counselor's office, he kept saying, well, if you don't tell me the name of the boy, there's nothing I can do about it, so just gotta get over it. If we can tolerate, maybe you're not ready to tell me the whole story right now, and we can be patient with that, it makes it safer, more likely the person will eventually come back and say, well, okay, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about what happened. So maybe we're not going to get the whole story right at first, and if we can tolerate that, we're more likely to get the rest of the story. The last bullet point that I talk about talking about it is something that I teach to all the new interns, learning therapists that are at our site. If the person doesn't want to talk, you can, again, kind of desensitize them to like, oh my gosh, I can never imagine that I would talk about it, by just making reference to the fact that maybe at some point in the future, you will feel like talking about it, and when that happens, I'm here to talk to you. So you just make a passing reference, you know, someday when you do feel like talking about it, I'm ready to listen. You know, someday when you're feeling a little bit better, maybe we could come back and visit this again. So you're just putting it out there in the future. They're imagining themselves maybe some point in the future that they might be able to talk about it. So it's, again, everything we're talking about here is trying to make a safe atmosphere in which the person can open up and get the kind of support that they need. Doesn't have to be talking. Could be music, could be, I read this thing the other day and made me think of you. Here's this poem I saw, here's this music, this song that I heard that I thought you might like. But I do think it's important, if someone is struggling and you're not sure whether we need to go get professional intervention, to maybe talk about, okay, you're saying you're doing all right right now. How would we know if things are getting worse that we really should go look for professional interventions? How will we know that things are really getting out of hand? When we're talking with anybody who's at any kind of risk, we're going to make a safety plan. And again, this is when we're a little bit calmer, we're going to think ahead and think about what are some things we can do to make ourselves feel safer. Things like what keep me going when times are hard, what are warning signs that might say that I'm struggling a little bit more, that I might notice, you might notice, and then making lists of ways that they can cope, things they can do on their own, things that they can do with somebody else, things that they might do that would make it worse than, let me remember, staying up all night is not a good idea. Things that you might notice or say that inadvertently would make things worse. I know we have this brochure out on the table, so I'm not sure if it's in every packet, but it's called Suicide Proof Your Home. And it's a really important concept that if someone is really at risk in the moment, that we would do things to secure any firearms that are in the home and lock up any medications until the peak of the danger has passed and the person would be safer. These are some signs that might indicate that maybe we are at the point where we need to seek some professional intervention. And remember that if you are supporting somebody, like if you're Clay, and you're trying to reach out to somebody who's really, really struggling, you probably gonna need support yourself. And lastly, I like this little graphic about 13 reasons why not. I think anything that we can put out there to remind people who can, when they're really, really hurting, can sort of lose perspective, is a helpful thing. All right, so now Chris is gonna talk about suicide prevention.